How are y'all doing today? It's, you know, it's a little overcast, it's a little rainy, but it's still a beautiful day. You know why? Because we're here in the house of the Lord. We've come together to be for a common reason. I don't know about you, but I am, if I don't move this, I'm going to take a header at some point. I am amazed today, especially. I mean, I'm amazed like this a lot, but because I see God working in a lot of areas, but I'm amazed on how he puts a service together. And I know I probably say this a lot, but you got to understand, even from announcements, you know, when Pastor Gene came up and gave the announcement about the White Bucket program, right? He didn't realize, but man, he is like on target with what I'm preaching on today. And that's just an announcement, right? Was there a children's church today? Children, you can go. They might be. My dad got up. That's why I thought about it. No, I'm just kidding. That's to just get you guys back from earlier. But you know, that's just that. And then we get into what Pastor Jason Smithy, I know that's confusing, isn't it? What he says, and what he comes up and delivers a story, doesn't realize how in tune it is to what I'm going to preach on today. Not only that, but the worship team practices and puts together a set of music, and every song goes exactly with what I'm going to preach on today. And I don't know about you, but that is only can be done by the God that we serve. Because we don't talk. If they're looking ahead, but man, I go so many different places, there's no way they can follow me. I am the untraceable. So, I mean, it's like, and yeah, it's like Travis just said, I don't try. I mean, literally, do you see God putting this together? And I want you, my heart is already on Resurrection Sunday. I want you to know that. So if I seemed a little jazzed today, it's because guess what? My Lord is risen. I mean, come on. That's exciting, right? And we serve this risen Lord, but I want to let you to know that we are starting. I want you to today, right today, I want you to, if you will promise with me, if you will covenant with me, and I don't use that word lightly, but if you would covenant with me today, that today you would say, Pastor, today I'm with you. We are going to begin today to prepare our hearts for resurrection. We're not preparing our heart for Jesus' death. No, we're preparing the fact that he is alive and well. And he's at home. John 14 says, and what is he doing? He's right now preparing a plate for us. So, I don't know about you, but that'll preach a long time. We could probably just settle into there. But I'm not going to do that. Come on. So we've been talking about the missing and forgotten pieces of armor. And we are looking at that being prayer and in the Spirit. So we walk in the Spirit, we pray in the Spirit, right? These are the things that we have to have, or the rest of the armor doesn't fit. This is what we've been talking about. And we've been in James. We've been everywhere, okay? And today, guess what? Today we're going to settle in just John 14, okay? We're just going to stay in 14. I know. We're just going to stay in 14 for a little bit. But I want to take you on something. And I believe, I wasn't sure even how to begin this thing. I believe that this is something the Lord has really spoken to my heart. He actually spoke into my heart of this during family camp, and not just the year of revival, but in one of the sessions we talked about a thing I'm going to talk about today. It's really been heavy on my heart. And as I've gone through this and I've looked at this, and my wife and I have been in prayer about it, and we've discussed it, and we've laid it out together. By the way, if you don't know this, she is just as much part of the preparation for my sermon as me. Just want you to know that. Thank you, darling. Because I have to talk it out. Now, I've got some other people I call, and usually probably not in the right timing, but I got to talk it out. So I do this thing. But I'm really convinced that this issue that I'm going to talk about today is the single most problem that we in the Western church face. And I personally believe that if we could solve this issue within the body of Christ, the church would be alive and well like it should be. Now, I'm not saying that we're not doing what we should. I'm not saying that. I'm not down in the church, but I'm telling you, I think that we're and I've said this, we're a little anemic at times. And so I want to kind of get into this a little bit. So we're going to start in John 14. We're going to hit verse 15, and we're going to work our way through as much as we can. But I'm just going to go ahead and read 15, and then we're going to talk a little bit about that, and then we're going to jump into some really deep stuff. And I want you to know, you need to be praying for me, because, man, the enemy is working overtime today. Because for the last several weeks, the enemy's been telling me I'm going too deep. I'm just telling you. I'm just being real honest, okay? And, I've taken that pretty much captive and said, well, you know what? That's just too bad. People are just going to have to get a ladder to get out of the hole I'm going to put them in, maybe. I don't know. So let me get into 15. It says, if you love me, you will keep my commands. That's John 14, 15. And I'm also going to jump into 16. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another counselor to be with you forever. Now, he starts off this discourse, and you have to understand what has been going on in this, in the book of John. This is what we call the beginning of his farewell discourse, as the theologians use these words. This is his farewell discourse. In other words, this is his last will and testament, if you will. How about that? Does that work for you? This is his last teaching. This is what he's doing this. And guess what is just timing? A coincidence? I think not. Here's the deal. What has he been doing? He has been with the disciples in the upper room, celebrating a Passover meal. And if you look at it, he's actually celebrating it early. I'll get into that later, maybe. And Judas just took off. He's just washed the disciples' feet. Do you see what's going on here? This is a critical point. You talk about a time of stress in Jesus' life, right? It's right now. And he's teaching and he's doing this. And 14, he gets in there. And then at the end of 14, he says, let's get away from here. And he goes and he starts walking to the Garden of Gethsemane and he teaches about the vine. This is where we're at, okay? So this is what's going on. So he's talking to them and he's all these things. And he says, hey, listen to me. If you love me, you will obey my commands. Now, a lot of us don't like this part because it sounds like, well, wait a minute, because God's love is unconditional, but yet he just said that in order to have his love, then I have to obey his commands. No, what does that mean? Well, we can really get messed up if we use our human thinking. The fact is he's saying, look, you love me, it will automatically happen. If you put your life into what Jesus is teaching us, if you say, okay, I surrender everything to the Lord, If I follow Messiah with everything, if I'm following Messiah so close that his dust is on me, then guess what? I am automatically going to do his commands. And then we all think, well, what is he talking about? Because in the Old Testament, there's a ton of commands. And what is he talking about? I'm going to just take you back to this too. Love God, love others. Love God, love others. Following Jesus should move us to the point of loving God and loving others. Now, he says, so do this. Then he says, and we put the word and in there. It's really, I don't know why we put it in there, but he says, because it really sounds like the only way you're going to get this is if you do this. But in a way, what he's saying is if you love God and love others and you're following Jesus, then he says, I'm going to send you something. I'm going to give you another gift, okay? And he says this. He says, I'm going to send you another comforter. Now, I want us to, we're going to look at comforter, we'll look at counselor, we'll look at helper. Because in your Gospels and in your translations, it's laid out here. And I know I've preached on this before, but you got to understand, I got to lay this thing down because we're talking about the foundation for us to actually walk in the Spirit and to pray in the Spirit. Everything I've been talking about is critical to this issue, and this is not any different. What He says, I want to focus in on the word another counselor. We skip over this. Jesus is saying, I am a counselor. I am a helper. I am here, but I am not going to be here. So I'm going to send you another counselor. And when he says another, it's really saying, I'm going to send you someone who does the same work that I do. Now tie that in with, what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to do the work of what? Jesus. So we're supposed to be these things. We're supposed to be a helper. We're supposed to be a comforter. We're supposed to be a counselor. Now we got to put our human stuff aside, right? Okay, so you're going to notice a theme today. I'm going to be comparing kingdom and the world versus culture, or world versus culture versus the kingdom. This is what I'm going to do. So I'm just going to do this. This is kind of a run through till we get to the next thing. So in the kingdom, we have a few names given for the Holy Spirit. We call him helper, comforter, and advocate. A helper gives us the power to do. Someone who comes alongside and gives us the power to do. Amen? Okay? Then you got a comforter. This is interesting because comforter is one of those words. Why do we need a comforter? Because in this world, you will have trouble. But take heart, I've overcome the world. So we're to be a comfort in times of trouble, in times of stress, in times of these things, in times of, we are to comfort, we are to balance, we are to level out. The scripture says that the valleys will be made, it will be raised up, and the mountains will be made low. That's a comfort. So when we look at this, that's what it is. And then the other word that it says, well, it's a counselor, but really it's a parakletos, which is advocate. We could go in as some people call it paraclete. That's this, but really the translation is parakletos, and it is it's an advocate, really having to do with the law, right? So a helper is Holy Spirit, a comforter, Holy Spirit, an advocate. Do you know what the advocate gives us? Freedom from sin and death. Isn't that what the advocate in front of the judge does? Because the Bible teaches that the wages of sin is, but the gift of God is eternal life. Freedom from that death. Freedom from that sentence. So when we're living life, and you have to understand, we're going to get to the point where Jesus is going to be taken, and he's going to be at the right hand of the Father, interceding for us, advocating for us, saying, hey, and when something goes wrong, because guess what? In this world, you will have trouble. In this world, you will have stuff go wrong. You will do wrong. Even if it's not outwardly, might be inwardly. Come on now. Isn't that the fight? I mean, we've trained ourselves pretty good about the outside things. We know what we're supposed to do. Now, sometimes we don't do what we're supposed to do, but we know. But it's the inside. It's those thoughts. It's the lust, the passion, the desires of things that are born in James. We learned in James that those things that are brought into us, they will give birth to sin. And then sin, once it's conceived, gives birth is death, right? I mean, but the advocate gives us freedom from that. Right? Okay, what does the world look like? A helper, we help ourselves, which means we step on others. The world, we're supposed to be a comfort to ourselves, so we get addictions and we lie. Or how about this? How about when the world says, we need to be an advocate for ourselves, therefore we justify and we blame. The difference between the kingdom and the world is clear. But we are supposed to be doing the work of Jesus. Therefore, we are to be what Jesus was to his disciples, what the Holy Spirit is to us. We are to turn around and be that for others who may not know who Messiah is, may not understand who Holy Spirit is. And so we reflect that. So we become that helper. We empower them to do what is right and to walk in righteousness. We comfort in times of trouble and distress. We advocate for righteousness in the lives of others. How are we doing with that? We could stop there right now. And we could carry this thought all week long, could we not? But when we add it to what we're going to go on to, I want you to know that this is huge. So And this was just really a trial run to see how we're going to do today with the rest of it. I'm sorry. Not really. Just being serious. So, I got notes everywhere, folks. Sorry, I got handwritten things. I got printed out things. I'm going to follow my own chicken scratch here. So it goes on and it says, so he's going to send us another counselor to be with us forever. Come on. This is not a short-term issue. Forever, eternity, not even as long as you shall live. We're going beyond the live. We're going into the days of Elijah. We're talking the days where we're going to be traveling to Jerusalem for the festivals because our Jesus is on the throne. I was talking to someone today. It's that time when God makes everything right and the cedars of Lebanon start regrowing and there becomes a forest in the middle of the desert. Come on! Forever. Say it forever with me. You see, many of us came to church today for a pep talk. I'm going to tell you. We sang these awesome, man, every song today, Travis. It's just like, yeah, I love the song. And man, I can get caught up in the music. Come on, come with me with this. Right? I can get caught up in it. I can get caught up in the emotion of what we're talking about. Like, come on, his love never fails. And I can get caught up in that emotion. But we're not here for a pep talk. We're not here for a motivational speech. We are here to hear what God has put on the heart for us. And we're here to say, you know what? What we sang about is not to get me going. What we sang about is to give praise because that's who he is to me. And I need you to put that in perspective because he sits here, he says forever. And then he says, he is the spirit of truth and the world is unable to see him because it does not see him or know him. But you do know him because he remains with you and will be in you. I will never leave you as orphans. I am coming to you. Now, we're going to break that all down. Okay, so we've been talking about the armor of God, right? And what was the first piece that we talked about? The belt of truth. And what did that belt of truth do? It held everything together. Well, now Jesus is saying, I'm going to send you another comforter, and his name is the Spirit of Truth. In other words, everything we say and do hangs on Holy Spirit. How we respond, what we act, how we say, what we learn, what we're being taught, what we teach others, how we counsel, how we comfort. If it is not hung on the Holy Spirit, then it is wrong. You may be getting good advice, right? But good advice is not empowered by the Holy Spirit. I think we need to stop giving good advice. I mean, you know, we got good news that the kingdom of God is here, and yes, the good advice is to join that kingdom, but really, that's a Holy Spirit-led conversation. Okay, so here's the deal. Good advice is, I'm using a real-life situation here, okay? Good advice is go to the doctor and have something checked out, right? That's good advice, right? But Holy Spirit advice is, hey, go to the doctor, go to God, and see who wins. God may say miraculously healed, but God may also say, I have given a gift and a talent to a man, and I want him to shine for my glory. There's a difference. Now, here's the thing. The Spirit of Truth. And you can throw up that slide now. We're going to try to do this as whatever we can. So in all reality, in life, whether you're in the kingdom or in the world, okay, we all long for the reality and truth. Now, I know you say, wait a minute, we live in a thing that says, well, it's there's not a definite truth, right? It's all relative. But it doesn't matter because everybody has a truth for themselves, so we're longing for that truth. So even if you believe in a relativism kind of life, then the fact is you're still seeking truth, and that truth to you is your reality, correct? So what we're going to do is we're going to look at the world and culture and see how it goes to the reality and truth. You can go ahead and click it. And then we're going to look at the kingdom, and we're going to see how we get to reality and truth, because in all actuality, that brings us down to the really crux of the knowledge, which is going to come straight down, and that is knowledge. You say, what do you mean, what is knowledge? The fact is that we all want to know something intimate. It's either going to be about, I want to know myself better, or I want to know something beyond myself better. We all long in this world for an intimacy. We've been made, do you understand we've been made for that? When God wired us, he has these two wires in there, intimacy, and he goes zap, and he put them together so that it would flow through us. That's why we, us guys, look like idiots when we see the girl of our dreams for the first time. You know? Because we want intimacy, we long for an intimacy with other person. But I'm going to tell you this, we've traded that intimacy. We really were designed to have intimacy with God. You see, in the Garden of Eden, it says that the Lord walked with Adam and Eve in the cool of the evening. They had intimate conversations. It was, you know, to me, that sounds kind of romantic, doesn't it? I know we don't think about this like with God, but I'm going there because we're also his bride. God knows I like long walks on the beach and dark chocolate. He knows that. God's a pretty romantic dude, actually. Have you read the book of Song of Solomon? I'm telling you. Okay. So here's the thing. We all want this. And in the garden, and in when everything is right, and I'm going to say when God is on the throne and he makes things right and he turns us all back into little gardens, there's a whole other conversation there. I can't even go there because it might blow your mind. But the fact is, and I don't want explosions everywhere. The fact is, because someone's got to clean that up. The fact is that when all that's set, we're going to say, oh, why have I been longing for this relationship? Oh, man, this is what I need. Do you know what I'm saying? So we're all looking for that. We're all looking for what that is. But, okay, so how does the world deal with it? The world deals with it with self, okay? And by the way, I forgot that was next. The fact is, and how we get to this stuff, to this knowledge, is by faith. Whether you believe in God or not, it's faith. Faith is not a church word. Faith is an action word. It is acting on what I believe in. So if I believe in self, then guess what? I'm going to act for that. If I believe in God, I'm going to act on that. That's where my faith stands. Do we all agree on this? Okay, so we're going to look at, they look at self. But what does the kingdom look like? What does the kingdom, how does they kind of go for this truth through faith? They are going to look at Holy Spirit. Well, we should. Now do you see where the crux of our problem comes into play? We should be dealing with Holy Spirit. To come to the reality and truth and to walk in this kind of faith can only be done by a helper, a comforter, and a counselor. Well, why is that? Well, let's go to the world. Under self, what do that happens? It's all about keeping my desires and my wants. It's about me. What does James 1 tell us? That we are dragged away and enticed by those evil things within us. And then that produces sin, and sin produces death, right? And if that is it, come on, how many have lived here where it's been like, look, all I got to do is it's all about me. I got to keep what I want and what I need right. Guess what? That doesn't work in marriages. That doesn't work in the church. When we put ourselves in front of everything that we do, and it's about what we get out of it and what benefits us, we have a huge problem. How does the kingdom look at it? We keep his commands. Love God, love others. John 14. Oh, by the way, within this also says, in this world you will have trouble. But take heart, I've overcome the world. Do you see? Now, all of a sudden, now you start seeing where the path that we should be walking and the path that we sometimes take. Now, I'm not saying we take this path all the time. Maybe. I'm thinking maybe we have become lazy in our relationship with Holy Spirit. All right, so we're going to go back to the world side. If we're keeping our own desires and wants, what does that really look like? It comes that everything is about sight and physical things. It's about touch and feel. Think about it. in the scripture verse, it says that the world can't see me or know me. But see, now, if we're following self, it is about all about us. And it's about the sight. It's about the physical. Okay, church, listen. When we are focused on self, our worship becomes about us and how people see us. Well, I just didn't feel the Spirit today. So you are the pin that makes the Spirit come and go? Oh, the scripture says, do not think more highly than yourselves than you ought. Or, oh, you know what? I just can't get into the service because our building is just, we're outdated. That's right. Well, or like, oh, not in this church, all right? Not in this church, but, oh, hymns. It's not so much the hymns, but it's that blasted organ. Hey, man, I've said it, and I know it. Right? I just can't worship that way. You know me. I don't like Southern gospel music at all. But I can tell you what. If that's all I got, I'll worship with it. Bluegrass. But I will tell you what, there's nothing like playing bluegrass with a bunch of guys. Why? Because it becomes not about the fellowship, or not about the music, it becomes about the brotherhood that you find. Hang that on your hat for just a second, okay? Just for a second. Or on your head, not your hat. You put that anyway. Okay. Let's go to the kingdom side. So it's about the world side, it's sight and physical, touch and feel. But on the kingdom side, it's about Hebrews 1:11. It is about things that are hoped for but not seen. Well, isn't that our definition of faith? From Hebrews 11:1? I mean, isn't that what it's saying? Maybe I should read that for you. Maybe that would help. This wasn't planned. Now, faith is the reality. That goes up there. Of what is hoped for, or truth. The proof of what is not seen. Wow. Okay. So, in worship, I don't have to feel the Holy Spirit. I don't even have to see the Holy Spirit. I just hope that the Holy Spirit's there. And if I can just grab onto that little bit of hope, man, that's all I need. That's faith. It's walking it out. Because I'm going to tell you what, folks, you know it, and I know it. There are times when you do not want to worship. You do not feel like giving thanks to God. You are angry at Him. Come on. But you got to, wait a minute. I'm going to take those thoughts captive because I know who I am in Jesus. But see, that gets to the crux of our discussion today. So we better keep going or we're not ever going to be able to even answer these things. All right, so we're back to the world and culture. So if we're about keeping my desire and wants, we're about sight and physical things, feel and touch, then what is that thing? All of a sudden it becomes our focus is on the outer things. It's on materialism. It's on what people see. I've got to work so hard so that people see me for who I am, which in all actuality is not really who you are. It's who you want them to see you as. Oh, it's about what I drive. It's about this. It's about that. No. See, when we're so focused on self and the outer things. I've been using worship because it was just the thing in front of me. But can you see where this hurts the church? In worship and well, how about not just, how about just living life in community within a church? Right? I mean, it's all of a sudden, now we get so stuck and it's all about, it becomes a religion. It becomes it's like going to a workaround. You know what a workaround is? It's when you have to go and order and you carry your own food back to your place, but a restaurant, go and they bring it to you. See, there's a big difference. We've turned a church into a workaround. We want to get fed, but we only feel like we can get fed if we do this, 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 and this. When God says, no, I want you to come and wait and rest in me, and I will give you the food that you need for that time. It doesn't mean we don't walk in righteousness. Because if we have the Spirit of Truth on and it's holding our righteousness in place and it's and we've got all the rest of the armor on and we're armored up and we've got the sword of the Spirit with us, right? We have these things and we're listening and we're using them. But when we get so focused on the other things, oh, this is too cumbersome. Bible study, quiet time every morning, really? Every evening? No, I can't. Lord, you want me to do it twice a day? Unheard of. I must be really bad. That's funny, right? But come on, how many have been there? All right. So let's go to the other side. If we're in the kingdom, Holy Spirit keeping his commands, not seen, what is the focus things? It's on relationships. God, Holy Spirit, and others. The things people can't see. Why? Because we don't need him to see it. We don't need him to see that that you got a note from so and so today. You don't need to know that that two people got together in such a critical point in someone's life and they came together and they prayed together. You don't need to know that. That's not our focus. The focus is on a healthy relationship with God and others. It's like I'm walking with my rabbi. I'm doing what I can. I'm trying to grow. I'm trying to have him grow me, and I'm going to be okay, and this is good. And then you know what? That translates automatically is that I'm going to be nice to people. And I'm going to try to live life the way Jesus wants me to, and I want to reflect his love and grace and mercy. So don't sit here and sing like an avalanche talking about God's grace when we can't give it to somebody else. First song we sang today, praise him. Praise him. All the people praise him. Yeah, we will when we get to things we want or if things are going our way. Oh, I'll praise him all day long. But if something turns the corner and I don't get what I want or I don't like, no, I'm not going to praise him. I'm going to sit down. I'm going to pout. Now, do you see what side of thinking is that? All right. Well, what does all this mean? Where am I going with this? It's going somewhere. And I believe this is the crux of our problem in the church. We'll get to it next week. I'm just kidding. Commercial break. It's called the orphan spirit. Now, here's the thing. I want to make this abundantly clear. If you are an orphan, you don't automatically have the spirit. Because we are all orphans. This spirit, and I really don't like saying naming a spirit, okay? Because the minute we put our human things on it, the enemy goes, whatever, I'm going to change my plan, and this is how it's going to be. Okay? But I needed to call it out for what it is. And I've been struggling with a definition here, okay? And the reason I've been struggling with a definition of, and we've talked about it at family camp, but what I've really been struggling is it is such a multifaceted problem that this creates. The longer we walk in self and in the world and culture, as we read, as long as we are friends with the world, remember that passage we read? The longer we stay there, that is where we go. And everything we do is found and we walk in that and we pray in that. So we're trading the hidden pieces of armor for man-made created pieces of armor. So what does this look like? First of all, because of what this is well, hang on. Let's go to the next one real quick and then I'll go. Okay, so the other one leads to walking or praying in the Spirit. This is about Holy Spirit. And I want you to know that I don't use the term the Holy Spirit. It is not he is not a thing. Okay? Which is the problem is how we taught. I know it's a little thing, but it automatically, in our English language, in our Western thought, we've automatically, when we put the in front of it, we automatically, well, that's just a thing. And it's killed us. What this is about and what we're looking at is the truth and reality of it is that God has designed and ordained and predestined each of us to be part of his family. What did the scripture say? I will not leave you as orphans. But we live our life as we are orphans. What is an orphan? I mean, this is where it gets difficult, because again, just because you're an orphan doesn't mean that you have the Spirit. Okay, I'm trying to be real careful, but the thing is if we don't have a support system, if we don't have somebody above us, then we're left alone to figure out what we need. And when so long we figure out what we need, you know, we've said, well, you got to go find yourself. No, we need to go lose ourselves. When we find ourselves, I'm going to tell you what you're going to find. You're going to find someone who's hurt and broken in need of Jesus. We need to lose ourselves in the fact that we are not God. We need to lose ourselves in the fact that, guess what? We have been created for a purpose and a destiny. And I don't even have to know what that is right now. The fact is that that's what I've been created for. And I'm going to walk in faith, even if I don't see it being done. The orphan spirit says, no, here's the deal. It's all about you. You got to fight and scrap for yourself. How many have been there? No, it's about me. But what am I getting out of this? What is my benefit? Oh, the church, you don't think that happens in the church? Oh, I'm doing this so I can go to heaven. That is sick thinking. And some of you are going, why is that sick thinking? I want to go to heaven. No, that is selfish. We should be saying, I want to lose my life so they can go to heaven. The church is operating in a spirit of being an orphan. We don't have belonging. We don't have purpose except for me. Oh, come on, people. I'm walking this out too. Because I'm going to tell you, it's easy to go there. I mean, it's so easy to go there. And we wonder why our prayer life is anemic. We wonder why I prayed for healing, but that didn't happen. We wonder why I've prayed for the gifts. And first of all, I'm going to say that sometimes praying for the gift is a sign of orphan spirit. Because we shouldn't be praying for the gifts. We should be praying for the fruit. And then all of a sudden the gifts come. You see? Because the gifts can be, I mean, the Bible says, hey, careful, gifts can be divisive. Gifts can say, well, this is, and we've done that in the church. We said, if you don't have this gift, then you aren't really filled. There's not one gift, there are many. You wonder why God's not speaking to you in prophecy like he used to. You wonder why your Bible study, you're not getting out of anything, what you used to get out, or anything. Oh, as a pastor I hear, oh man, I read the word, but I just can't get anything out of it. I went to church today and I didn't get anything out of the message. Instead of saying, you know, I went to church today and that message today wasn't for me, but I know it was for somebody else. So I spent my time in prayer and praise asking God to speak to this for this message. Do you see a difference in how our attitude becomes? I'm going to tell you this. You, maybe the boldest statement I ever make. Okay? And I know I've said a lot of them. Paul's going, oh boy, here we go. Fasten the seatbelt. You cannot walk in the Spirit. You cannot pray in the Spirit if you are in the orphan spirit. The two don't mix. Why does God say you can't serve God in money? Because money is not the root of evil. It's the love of money that is the root of evil. And what is that about? It's about me, baby. That is an orphan spirit. And we say, well, there's a lot of things that we do in this orphan spirit. We don't even realize how we treat people, how all this stuff. I mean, our motives behind why we do what we do. And we wonder why the church is anemic. There is a world out there. There is a world out there beyond you that needs the love of Jesus. It may be in your neighborhood. It may be at your job. It may be in another state. It may be in another country. I guarantee you, there is someone, any place you set your foot, that needs the love of Jesus. And if we can't focus on that, and we're just focusing on our convenience and our comfort, we are going to miss the opportunity. There are people dying for their faith every day. I wear this bracelet called Imprisoned With Them, and it's from the Voice of the Martyrs, to remind me. It's given to me, and I love it because it reminds me that it's not about me. You see, I made a statement to a youth group a long time ago, and I was questioned about it, but I stand by it, and I still stand by it today, and I say it for you, and I've said it from here before, and I'm going to say it again, and I'm going to say it till I die. If I could trade my salvation for yours, I would do it in a heartbeat, because it's not about me. I'm not saying that to say, oh, look at him. No. That is because of what God has brought me through and has taught me. I don't want to be about me, because if it's about me, I mess it up. Sometimes decisions have to be made, and it seems like, well, that's about him. No, sometimes there's decisions that have to be made because that is what's best for the kingdom at that moment. I don't know where we've gotten off, church. See, we've missed the promises of the word because we're so wrapped up in self. Do you see how critical this is for us in the Spirit, walking in the Spirit, speaking in the Spirit, praying in the Spirit? And again, I told you, when we started this thing, you got to throw all your theological and doctrinal basis aside. Because I'm not talking speaking in tongues. I'm not talking about I'm talking about a surrendered obedience that when he says go, just like Abraham, we go. Without knowing. Because the truth is, Abraham knew who God was. And he trusted God enough to say, I don't have to go. He hung his journey on the belt of truth and on the Spirit of truth. We don't contact people that we should in the church because we're not listening. We think there's somebody else paid to do that. Yo, it's only me, y'all. Yeah. I mean, my heart hurts. The world is unable to receive him because it doesn't see him or know him, because his church isn't acting like him. He says, he looks at these disciples and says, you know me. He says, you know me. You've been with me. You've seen me. And I'm not going to leave you as an orphan. I am coming to you. He automatically says, this, if you don't believe in the Trinity, you've got to throw this whole book out. Because it's saying, God the Father, and he's saying, I'm going to send another counselor, and I'm coming to you. He ties himself in and he says, this is who. We're one and the same. Then he says, in a little while, you won't see me. The world will see me no longer. I made a statement today. If the devil knew what he knows today about Jesus and about resurrection, he would have never put Jesus on the cross. But the problem is the church doesn't live like that. He says, a little while the world won't see me longer, but he says, but you will see me spiritualize. Things not seen. You see, we think, well, wait a minute. He says he won't see me, but now we're going to see me. Well, isn't that a contradiction? No. He's saying the world can't see me. But you can, because I'm giving you the power to do it through the helper. I'm giving you the comforter. So when you see things going bad, you can be comforted. And I'm here to tell you that I'm giving you an advocating for you so that you know that your future is secure. Says, but you will see me because I live, you will live. Think about that statement. He's getting ready to go to the cross. He's getting ready to say, it is finished. And the devil's going to applaud. Because guess what? See, that's why I said it's not the death of Jesus that saves us. Because the death was the thing that the devil thought would keep that man down. The blood was shed. We were saved. The death was the devil thinking he had an upper hand. It's not about the death. It's about the resurrection. We've already been saved. What's the resurrection about? Man, it's our celebrating we live, but it's also the empowerment for us to understand who we are and who we say, I am no longer a slave to fear. I am not an orphan any longer. Orphans are afraid. And I'm talking even true orphans are afraid. But we're no longer a slave to that fear. Why? Because I'm a child of God. He lives. You will live. That's why he says, take up your cross and follow me. In other words, you sacrifice yourself for others because that's not what your life is not about how you live. You live because I live. That's why that's so important for us to get, because if it was his death, then we would just die. But it's not. He lives, so we live. The church needs to start walking like we're alive. We need a revival. We need a Holy Spirit. Bonafide, charged, clear, boom! Yeah, we need a little bit of Holy Spirit adrenaline pumped in our heart. Oh, now listen to this. And in that day, you will know that I am in my Father. Listen. You are in me, and I am in you. What more do I need to say? Can I add to that? You see, the one who has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father. I also will love him and reveal myself to him. We cannot have a revelation of the Lord in the orphan spirit. We can only have a revelation from the Lord when we are walking. And I'm not talking about revelation of salvation, because that comes to everybody. But I'm talking about the revelation of I'm in a hard spot and I don't know what to do. And he says, peace I give you, peace I leave with you. That's a revelation. The promises is that God says, promises that we miss is that God says, you are no longer an orphan. Promise number two is that I am coming to you. Maybe it's the fact that the church really doesn't want God to reveal himself, because within him, light comes, and light will expose the darkness that is found in the house of the God. And I am really not talking about legalism. It's not about rules and regs. It's about surrender and resurrection. Then Judas, love how my Bible puts it, not Iscariot, said to him, "Lord, how is it that you're going to reveal yourself to us and not to the world?" I don't think it was how you're going to do it. I think it should have been why. Because I think this young man thought, "But don't they want the world to see it all? And now you're just saying that you're only going to reveal yourself to us?" And he knows them. He's lived with them. He knows Thomas. He knows Peter. He knows John and James. Why not? Why are you doing it this way? I don't understand. I want you to know it's okay to tell God you don't understand. He says this. He says, "If anyone loves me, he'll keep my word. My Father will love him, and we will come to him, and we'll make our home with him." You know, here's the thing where Jesus is not answering the question. He's being a comforter. Judas, don't worry about it. You don't have to know the why. The fact is, I'm going to come. Did you hear what he just said? And I'm going to make, we are going to make our home with you. Really, with? Bad translation. It's a preposition of location. It means, pretty much, I'm going to make our home within you. Then, the one who doesn't love me, he won't keep my words. The word that you hear is not mine, but it's from the Father who sent me. I've spoken these things to you while I remain with you, but the Counselor, the Holy Spirit, the Father will send him in my name, will teach you all things and remind you of all I have told you. This whole conversation, this question answered, or the question asked but not answered, is really teaching us something very important. The reason that he said, "I'm going to reveal myself to you and not the world," is because the purpose of the disciples, of the Talmudim, us, is that we are to reveal Jesus to the world. We are to be walking in the Spirit so that they see not us, but they see Jesus. They see the works that he's doing. They see all these things. He's saying, "Do you understand?" He goes, "I'm going to send you the Spirit of truth. I'm going to send you this Counselor. I'm going to send you this Comforter. I'm going to send you this Advocate. I'm going to send him to you. And guess what? He will teach you what you need to know when you need to know it. And he will remind you to love God and love others." And together with that information, it's going to be amazing, because he goes on and he closes this verse, and I can't believe I'm going to get through it all. He closes John 14 with this statement, and it says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you." He is talking about Holy Spirit deep within us. See, that's the point. It's not you doing any of it. It's him working through you. Until we surrender, we can't achieve. The problem is the church wants to achieve and then surrender. We want to say, "Look what I've done. Look how good I am. Okay, now you can have me." And the Lord's saying, "Go away from me. I never knew you." He said, I mean, what he's saying is, look. We, church, have been given a gift. We have been given a responsibility. He goes on to say, "Do you understand that this peace, that's the Holy Spirit, this gift I give to you, it's the Holy Spirit." He says, "I do not give to you as the world gives." The world gives with a backhanded motive. Have you ever bought a used car? Just saying. See, the Lord isn't saying, I'm giving you this. I'm giving you this as a little token. I'm giving you this so that you'll walk with me. I'm giving the, you know what? You know, this is the thing. I give my children money when I want something done that I don't want to do. Like, we got a microwave right now that's screaming to be cleaned out. And there's money on the table. It's just got to be done. But here's the thing, Kent. Here's the thing. God didn't do that with Holy Spirit. But we've treated it that way. Well, I'll pick up Holy Spirit off the table when I want it. When it's convenient for me. Folks, do you understand? The world gives with a backhanded, God gives with pure love and motive. Pure love and motive, by the way, doesn't mean it's easy. Have you noticed when it's given to in the backhand, it's always easy? All you got to do is make 4 easy payments of $99.99.99 plus shipping and handling, but 14,000 times more than what it's worth. Oh, we'll give you another one free if you pay that other shipping and handling. Do you see what I'm saying? God doesn't give that way. He says, I don't give that way. Then he repeats, your heart must not be troubled. Church, why are we so afraid? I was going to say scared. Why are we so afraid of who's in office? Why are we so afraid? It is going to be touchy. I'm sorry. Of who's allowed into our country. Sorry. Why are we afraid? Your heart must not be troubled. I'm telling you what. The church acts in fear. It's a sin. You have heard me tell you, I am going away and I'm coming to you. If you love me, you would have rejoiced that I'm going to the Father. When was the last time we had a praise and worship service because Jesus ascended to heaven? You would have rejoiced that I'm going to the Father because the Father is greater. In other words, you would want me to be with the Father. I have told you now before it happens so that when it does happen, not that it might happen, but that it does happen, you may believe. I will not talk with you much longer because the ruler of this world is coming. He has no power over me. On the contrary, I am going away so that the world may know that I love the Father. Just as the Father commanded me, so do I. Now get up and leave this place. I don't think it was like, okay, it's time to go get a drink. Get up and do it. Because we're not going to go there because I'm done with 14. We're going to go somewhere else. But I'm telling you, what they're going is the reason I've told you this is because I'm going to the cross, kids. We need to go to this garden. You need to hear what I'm talking about. You need to see that what I've told you, how many times over the last 3 years that this is taking place. You are going to have to put into practice what I just told you. Are you going to follow in the Comforter and in Holy Spirit? Or are you going to follow the world and you're going to scream, Hosanna for rebellion? Or what are you going to do? Are you going to be about yourself or are you going to be about your Father's business? And I think for so long the church has been about itself and not the Father's business. Team, why don't you come on up? One of the very important things that we need to understand and the promises I've already told you, we're not leaving to the orphan, I'm coming to you. He also says that the enemy has no power over him, therefore he has no power over us because he is in us. okay? The other thing I want you to know is that he says at the end, he goes, so the words you're hearing are not mine. They are from the Father, and I am doing what the Father commands me to do. Therefore, I command you also. See, problem is, though, we've been walking in the wrong spirit. You see, the orphan spirit says, I have to work for my love and my grace and my mercy. The orphan spirit says, it's about me. The orphan spirit says, God can do it for others, but he won't do it for me. The orphan spirit says, I am full of shame. There's something wrong with me. The orphan spirit says, I wish I had a better testimony. The orphan spirit says, there's no way that God could ever forgive me because of everything I've done. The orphan spirit is afraid to step into the light. They don't want to be exposed. They don't want that darkness. The church, church, church. Will we be a people who says, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I'm a child of God. And I'm going to walk in the Spirit. And I'm going to pray in the Spirit. And I'm going to do the jobs of Holy Spirit's doing for me. I'm going to walk in these. I'm going to be a comfort to people. I'm going to be a help. I'm going to counsel. And I'm going to advocate. In other words, I'm going to go before God and say, God, he is one of yours. It's putting yourself aside. It's not making excuses any longer. Because if we're making excuses and we're blaming and we're justifying our action, we are living in the orphan spirit. The Lord moves. If you need to come and give surrender, there's stones to make your living stone here. Yeah. Whatever the Lord is telling you, the Spirit is moving in you. I know he is. I believe, I'm going to say this, I believe that the Lord spoke to every single person about one thing in their life today. He promised me that was going to happen. And I believe it. I can't see it. But I'm walking that's how it is. So you're going to choose to walk in the Spirit, or you're going to choose to walk in that orphan spirit and not surrender. That's what we're going to open this up. Go ahead, guys.